Hi students, this is Dr. P.A. Rajeshwari, Assistant Professor in the Department of Food Science and Nutrition, Avinashilingam Institute for Home Science and Higher Education for Women, Coimbatore, is standing before you to present a topic on lactation in relation to growth and health of the infant. Optimal infant feeding practices rank among the most effective interventions to improve infants' health. In 2006, an estimated 9.5 million children died before their first birthday, and 2/3 of these deaths occurred in the first year of life. Undernutrition is associated with at least 35% of child's death. Around 32% of children less than 5 years of age in developing countries are stunted, and 10% are wasted. It is estimated that suboptimal breastfeeding, especially non-exclusive breastfeeding in the first 6 months of life, results in 1.4 million deaths and 10% of the disease burden in children younger than 5 years. To improve the situation, mothers and families need support to initiate and sustain appropriate infant and young child feeding practices. Now, let us see about the importance of breastfeeding for the growth of infant. Exclusive breastfeeding is the preferred method of infant feeding for the first 4 to 6 months of life. Adequate nutrition during infancy and early childhood is essential to ensure growth, health, and development of children to their full potential. Inappropriate nutrition can also lead to childhood obesity, which is an increasing public health problem in many countries. Early nutritional deficits are also linked to long-term impairment in growth and health. Malnutrition during the first 2 years of life causes stunting, leading to the adult being several centimeters shorter than his or her potential height. There is evidence that adults who are malnourished in early childhood have impaired intellectual performance. They also have reduced capacity for physical work. If the women were malnourished as children, their reproductive capacity is affected. The infants may have lower birth weight and they have more complicated delivery. When many children in a population are malnourished, it has implications for national development. The overall functional consequences of malnutrition are thus immense. The first 2 years of life provide a critical window of opportunity for ensuring children's appropriate growth and development through optimal feeding. Based on evidences of the effectiveness of interventions, achievement of universal coverage of optimal breastfeeding could prevent 13% of deaths occurring in children less than 5 years of age globally, while appropriate complementary feeding practices would result in an additional 6% reduction in under 5 mortality. Now, let us move on to the global strategy for infant and young child feeding, shortly called as IYCF. In 2002, the World Health Organization and UNICEF adopted the global strategy for infant and young child feeding. The strategy was developed to revitalize world attention to the impact that feeding practices have a positive impact on the nutritional status, growth and development, health and survival of infants. WHO and UNICEF's goal recommendations for optimal infant feeding as set out is the global strategy, which are exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months, that is 190 days, nutritionally adequate and safe complementary feeding starting from the age of 6 months with continued breastfeeding up to 2 years of age or beyond. Exclusive breastfeeding means that an infant receives only breast milk from his or her mother or a nurse, or expressed breast milk and no other liquids or solids, not even water, with an exception of oral rehydration solutions, drops or syrups consisting of vitamins, mineral supplements or medicine. Next is complementary feeding. Complementary feeding is defined as the process starting when breast milk is no longer sufficient to meet the nutritional requirement of infants, and therefore other foods and liquids are needed along with breast milk. The target range of complementary feeding is generally taken to be 6 to 23 months of age, even though breastfeeding may continue beyond 2 years. These recommendations may be adapted according to the needs of the infants and in young children in exceptionally difficult circumstances such as preterm or low birth weight infants, severely malnourished children, and in emergency situations. Specific recommendations apply to infants born to HIV infected mothers. Let us now see about breastfeeding. Breastfeeding confers short-term and long-term benefits on both child and the mother, including helping to protect children against a variety of acute and chronic disorders. The long-term disadvantages of not breastfeeding are increasingly recognized based on the frequency of occurrence of repeated episodes of infection leading to malnutrition. Reviews of studies from developing countries show that infants who are not breastfed are 6 to 10 times more likely to die in the first month of life than infants who are breastfed. Diarrhea and pneumonia are more common and more severe in children who are artificially fed and are responsible for many of these deaths. Diarrheal illnesses is also more common in artificially fed infants, even in situations with adequate hygiene. Other acute infections, namely Haemophilus influenza, meningitis, and urinary tract infections, are less common and less severe in breastfed infants. Artificially fed children have an increased risk of long-term diseases with an immunological basis, including asthma and other atopic conditions like type 1 diabetes, celiac disease, ulcerative colitis, and Crohn's disease. Artificial feeding is also associated with a greater risk of childhood and leukemia. Obesity in later childhood and adolescence is less common among breastfed children, and there is a dose response effect with a longer duration of breastfeeding associated with a lower risk. The effect may be less clear in populations where some children are undernourished. A growing body of evidence links artificial feeding with risks to cardiovascular health, including increased levels of blood pressure, altered blood cholesterol levels, and atherosclerosis in later adulthood. Increased duration of breastfeeding has been associated with greater intelligence in late childhood and adulthood, which may affect the individual's ability to contribute to society. For the mother, breastfeeding also has both short-term and long-term benefits. The risk of postpartum hemorrhage may be reduced by breastfeeding immediately after delivery, and there is increasing evidence that the risk of breast and ovarian cancer is less among who breastfed their children. Colostrum and mature milk. Colostrum is the special milk that is secreted in the first 2 to 3 days after delivery. It is produced in small amounts, about 40 to 50 ml on the first day, but is all that an infant normally needs at this time. Colostrum is rich in white blood cells and antibodies, especially immunoglobulin A, and it contains a larger percentage of protein, minerals, and fat-soluble vitamins, namely vitamin A, E and K, then later milk. Vitamin A is important for the protection of eye and for the integrity of epithelial surfaces and often makes the colostrum yellowish in color. Colostrum provides important immune protection to an infant when he or she is first exposed to the microorganisms in the environment. And epidermal growth factor helps to prepare the lining of the gut to receive the nutrients in the milk. It is important that infants receive colostrum and not other feeds at this time. Milk starts to be produced in larger amounts between 2nd and 4th day after delivery, making the breast feel full. The milk is then said to have come in. On the 3rd day, an infant is normally taking about 300 to 400 ml per 24 hours and on the 5th day, 500 to 800 ml. From the day 7 to 14, the milk is called transitional and after 2 weeks, it is called mature milk. Other aspect to be given more importance is exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months. The advantage of exclusive breastfeeding compared to partial breastfeeding were recognized in 1984 when a review of available studies found that the risk of death from diarrhea of partially breastfed infants from 0 to 6 months of age was 8.6 times the risk for exclusively breastfed children. For those who received no breast milk, the risk was 25 times that of those who were exclusively breastfed. Partial breastfeeding was associated with 4.2 times the risk of death, while no breastfeeding had 14.2 times the risk of death. Exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months has been found to reduce the risk of diarrhea and respiratory illness compared with exclusive breastfeeding for 3 to 4 months respectively. If the breastfeeding technique is satisfactory, exclusive breastfeeding for the first 6 months of life meets the energy and nutrient needs of the vast majority of infants. No other foods or fluids are necessary during the first 6 months of life. Healthy infants do not need additional water during the first 6 months if they are exclusively breastfed, even in a hot climate. Breast milk itself is 88% water and is enough to satisfy baby's thirst. Extra fluids displace breast milk and no doubt increase overall intake. Mothers who breastfed exclusively and frequently have less than a 2% risk of becoming pregnant in the first 6 months after postpartum, provided that they still have amenorrhea. Now we will see about complementary feeding from 6 months. From the age of 6 months, an infant need for energy and nutrients to exceed what is provided by the breast milk and complementary feeding becomes necessary to fill the energy and nutrient gap. If the complementary foods are not introduced at this age or if they are given inappropriately, an infant's growth may flatten. Even after complementary foods have been introduced, breastfeeding remains a critical source of nutrients for the young infant and child. It provides about one half of an infant's energy needs up to the age of 1 year and up to one third during the second year of life. Breast milk continues to supply higher quality nutrients than complementary foods and also protective factors. It is therefore recommended that breastfeeding on demand continues with adequate complementary feeding up to 2 years or beyond. Complementary foods need to be nutritionally adequate, safe, hygienic, and appropriately fed in order to meet the young child's energy nutrient demands. However, complementary feeding is often fraught with problems. with foods being too dilute, not fed often enough, or in too low amounts, or replacing breast milk while being an inferior quality. Both food and feeding practices influence the quality of breastfeeding, and mothers and families need to support to practice good complementary feeding. Now, let us discuss in detail about the composition of breast milk. Breast milk contains all the nutrients that an infant needs in the first 6 months of life, including fat, carbohydrates, proteins, vitamins, minerals, and water. It is easily digested and efficiently used. Breast milk also contains bioactive factors that augment the infant's immature immune system, providing protection against infection and other factors that help digestion and absorption of nutrients. Fats. Breast milk contains about 3.5 gram of fat per 100 ml of milk, which provides about one half of the energy content of the milk. The fat is secreted in small droplets and the amount increases the feed progress. As a result, the hind milk secreted towards the end of a feed is rich in fat and looks creamy white, while the foremilk at the beginning of the feed contains less fat and looks somewhat bluish gray in color. Breast milk contains long chain fatty acids, namely polyunsaturated fatty acids and arachidonic acid, that are not available in other milks. These fatty acids are important for the neurological development of a child. DHA and RAA are added to some variety of infant formula, but this does not contain any advantage over breast milk and may not be as effective as those in breast milk. Next, carbohydrate. The main carbohydrate is the special milk sugar lactose, a disaccharide. Breast milk contains about 7 gram lactose per 100 ml, which is more than that of most other milks and is another important source of energy. Another kind of carbohydrate present in breast milk is oligosaccharides, a sugar chain which provide important protection against infection. Next comes protein. Breast milk protein differs in quantity and quality from animal milk, and it contains a balance of amino acids which makes it much more suitable for a baby. The concentration of protein in breast milk is lower than in animal's milk. The much higher protein in animal milks can overload the infant's immature kidney with waste nitrogen products. Breast milk contains less of the protein casein, and this casein in breast milk has a different molecular structure when compared to animal milk. It forms much softer, more easily digested curds than that in other milks. Among the whey or soluble protein, human milk contains more alpha-lactoalbumins. Cow's milk contains beta-lactoglobulins, which is absent in human milk and to which infants can become intolerant. Next comes vitamins and minerals. Breast milk normally contains sufficient vitamins for an infant unless the mother is deficient. The exception is vitamin D. The infant needs exposure to sunlight to generate endogenous vitamin D. The minerals, iron and zinc, are present in relatively low concentration, but their bioavailability and absorption is high, provided that maternal iron status is adequate. Term infants are born with the store of iron to supply their needs. Only infants born with low birth weight may need supplements before 6 months. Delaying clamping of the cord until pulsations have stopped has been shown to improve infant's iron status during the first 6 months of life. Anti-infective factors. Breast milk contains many factors that help to protect an infant against infection, including immunoglobulin, principally secreted as immunoglobulin A, which coats the intestinal mucosa and prevents bacteria from entering the cells, white blood cells, which can kill microorganisms, whey protein, which can kill bacteria, viruses, and fungi, oligosaccharides, which prevent bacteria from attaching to mucosal surfaces. The protection provided by these factors is unequivocally valuable for an infant, which is not obtained by other milk. First, they protect without causing the effects of inflammation, such as fever, which can be dangerous for a young infant. Second, immunoglobulin A contains antibodies formed in the mother's body against the bacteria in her gut and against infections that has encountered. So they protect against bacteria that are particularly likely to be in the baby's environment. Other bioactive factors present only in breast milk are bile salt stimulated lipase, which facilitates the complete absorption of fat once the milk has reached the small intestine. Fat in artificial milk is less completely digested. Next is the epidermal growth factor, which stimulates the maturation of the lining of the infant's intestine so that it is better able to digest and absorb nutrients and is less easily infected and sensitized to foreign proteins. It has been suggested that other growth factors present in human milk target the development and maturation of nerves and retina in young infants. Students, let me now highlight the unique constituents of breast milk. Decoxohexaenic acid, necessary for the growth and development of the brain and retina and for myelination of nervous tissue. Cholesterol enhances myelination of nervous tissue. Taurin, second most abundant amino acid in human milk, important for bile acid conjugation. Next is the choline, which enhances the memory power of the infants. Next comes the enzymes. Numerous enzymes such as lipase that is important in digestion and absorption of fat. Next is lactoferrin, which prevents iron from being available to bacteria. Next is the inositol, which enhances synthesis and secretion of surfactant in immature lung tissue. Next, poly and oligosaccharides. These inhibit bacterial binding to mucosal surfaces. Next comes the protein alpha-lactalbumin, which supplies amino acids to the infant, help synthesize lactose in the mammary gland and bind calcium and zinc. Then Bifidobacterium species, which is predominant bacterial flora in the gastrointestinal tract of the breastfed infants, which creates unfavorable pH conditions for the growth of enteric pathogens. Then comes the macrophages. Macrophages in human colostrum have high concentration of immunoglobulin A, which is released during phagocytosis. Last is the epidermal growth factor, which promotes cell proliferation in the gastrointestinal mucosa. Coming to the benefits of breastfeeding for the mothers, breastfeeding is more than 98% effective as a method of contraception during the first 6 months, provided that breastfeeding is exclusive and amenorrhea persists in the mother. when the baby is breastfed immediately after birth, breast milk production is stimulated. Immediate and frequent suckling prevents engorgement of the breast. Breastfeeding reduces the mother's workload. Breast milk is available anytime and anywhere and is always clean, nutritious and available at the right temperature. Breast milk is economical when compared to artificial formulas. It stimulates a bond between mother and the baby. Next, breastfeeding reduces the risk of premenopausal breast and ovarian cancer. Next comes the benefits of breastfeeding for the whole family. No expenses in buying infants artificial formula. No medical expenses due to sickness that infant formula could cause. The mothers and their children are healthier. As episodes of illness are reduced, the family encounters fewer emotional difficulties associated with the baby's illness. Births are spaced due to the contraceptive effect. Next, time is saved. Last, feeding the baby reduces the work because the milk is always available and ready. Next comes the benefits of breastfeeding for the community and the nation. Not importing infant formula and utensils necessary for its preparation saves hard currencies that are earned and that could be used for something else. Healthy babies make a healthy nation. Decrease in the number of episodes of child illness leads to decreased national expenses for medical treatments. Fourth point, it improves child survival and reduces child mortality and morbidity. Last one, it protects the environment, that is, trees are not used for firewood to boil water, milk and utensils. Breast milk is a natural renewable source. Last to conclude, the average breastfed baby doubles its birth weight in 5 to 6 months. By the end of 1 year, a typical breastfed baby weighs about 2.5 times its birth weight. Breastfed babies begin to drop below the median beginning at 6 to 8 months and were significantly lower weight than the formula fed groups between 16 and 18 months. Hence, continuous breastfeeding is the best gift in the world to the infant by the mother.